topic for today, which is literally really all about how do we integrate our faith into our work. And where we begin is actually we ask the obvious question of why is this topic even important, right? Why should you, as a Christian, as a leader, as somebody who's involved in business, even care about this topic, right? And where we begin is the Westminster Catechism, which is basically a summary of Christian doctrine. And one of the first questions they ask there is the question, what is the chief end of men? In other words, why do you and I exist? What is our purpose exactly, right? And of course, the answer comes back an adaptation of Isaiah 43. And it basically says those words, the chief end of men is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. The chief end of men is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. And if that is not convincing enough, in Mark chapter 12, a scribe runs up to Jesus and says, Rabbi, Rabbi, what is the greatest of all the commands? And Jesus responds with that response right there. And he says, the greatest of the command is this, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Now, if you are like most people, the reality is you will spend anything between 60 to 80% of the time when you are awake at a place called work, a job, right? And for those of you who are running businesses, you will spend it at your business, right? And so, is it logically possible for you to glorify God with every single thing that you are, or to love Him with your entire being, like He says, if the place where you spend so much of your time, you are not intentionally and deliberately trying to do that? And of course, the answer is no, it's not possible. It's impossible to do that. It's impossible to obey that, right? Now, why do so many of us still struggle with doing exactly that? And what we want to introduce is this concept of dualism, which is a disease, which is a lie, right? And for many of us in the African context also, there's another thing called animism, right? Dualism, on the other hand, is this idea that somehow we can separate life into two categories. So there is spiritual and worldly things. There is secular things and there is sacred things, right? And what it does is it basically creates this type of lifestyle where the only things that are meaningful, that God really cares about, are the things that we can put in the spiritual side of things, the sacred things, right? Animism, on the other hand, is a little bit different. It's on the other extreme. It's a form of spiritism. It's a form of saying, you know, the creation has spirits in it, right? That is dualism. And because the creation has spirits, there is this aspect of power, and there's this aspect of somehow God is far, far away, and there's all these powers that are in between, and somehow I need to be able to manipulate power and bring it in such a way that it works for my favor, right? And for many of us Christians, sometimes we do great things like fasting, you know, and we're trying to manipulate power. How do I get it into my little corner? Holy water, or whatever. I mean, I don't want to list all the things. But really, it is characterized by fear. It is characterized by fear. Now, some of the examples of dualism is things, you know, we speak about the sacred secular work, right? For those of us who have been involved or are involved in Christian ministry, we know what it's like to be called, right? That is spiritual work. I've been called by God. And what it does is, for those who are not necessarily pastors or missionaries, we often find ourselves in this corner where it's a little bit awkward of, okay, but where exactly do I stand? Can I really please God with my life? And it forces us into a corner where it's like, maybe I need to join the ushering team so I can serve a church. Maybe I need to go on a
Christian ministry outreach so that I can also do the spiritual things, right? And that is so sad. That is a lie. You know, Paul writes in Colossians and he says, whatever you do, work at it with your entire being. Whatever you do. And there's a part actually where he says, whether you eat or drink, do all for the glory of God. Is something as simple as eating or drinking is meant to be done for the glory of God? What more? Your work, right? Private versus public, right? One of the things that this type of mindset tends to do is it takes the Bible, which of course is a spiritual sacred book, and it relegates it to this place where now it can only speak to my spiritual life. It can only teach me about prayer. It can only teach me about how I engage in my church life. But can it really speak to me about how I do my business? That's my public life, right? And it basically robs it of its power. For animism, one of the examples there that I have is this whole idea of bribery, right? And somehow because God is a little bit removed, I somehow need to be able to manipulate power in case I need my business license, I'm struggling, right? How do I manipulate the powers? And that mindset can easily say, does God really care if I pay a bribe? If it justifies the end, it's for a good cause, right? That's a form of what we tend to do, those of us who are animistic. But let's move on from there. What is really at stake, however, when we continue to live our lives like that? Some of the things that we do when we continue like that to live like that is, number one, a rightful worship of God, right? Now, supposing this bottle here represents my life as Ofhentse, literally every single thing, my church life, my business life, my family, and all that I am is encapsulated in this bottle. If I was to now take this bottle, right, and take what is the lion part of my life and say, doesn't really matter to God, I'm gonna put it to the side, right? Because that's what you do when you do dualistic living. My work, which is where I spend a lot of my life, and I'm like, God doesn't really care about that. What have I just done? I have just stolen. I have just robbed God of what is rightfully His. Remember we said you and I, we exist for the glory of God, every single thing. Now, if I am not honoring God with the chief or the lion portion of my life, it's called stealing. You have stolen from God. There's a famous quote by Abraham Kuyper, and it basically says, there is not a square inch in the whole of the human domain over which Christ, who is sovereign over all, does not cry, mine, it belongs to me, right? What about the maturing of the believer? You know, Paul writes in 2 Corinthians that we all with unveiled faces, we contemplate the Lord's glory, and as we continue to contemplate, we are transformed, right? Now, for people who think with the dualistic mindset, you might think this process of sanctification that Paul is describing, surely it only happens at church, or when I'm reading my Bible, or when I'm singing my favorite worship music, right? And all of that is right. You are telling the truth when you say that. But you know, when you go to scripture, the men and women of God, where is the place where we see the biggest transformation taking place in their life? Is it not when they are taking care of their livestock, when they encounter God, when struggling to conceive and crying out to God, right? It's in the day-to-day living where the whole process of sanctification actually happens, and God begins to expose idolatry, right? God begins to form their character. And so when you and I live with a dualistic mindset that thinks that transformation only happens when I'm doing the spiritual things, then you and I, we miss an incredible opportunity to experience this process, this maturing process that Paul describes. But also, what about the believability of the gospel? In 1 Peter chapter 2, Paul, the apostle Peter writes to the church and he says, keep your conduct among the Gentile honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. How many of you here have come to faith because you saw somebody whose life and conduct just spoke something that was so unique, right? If you and I, as Christians, we go to work on Monday and I'm like, I'm going to leave my Christianity behind at home, how are they going to see this conduct that they're going to look and say, wow, right? I have to believe what this man has been preaching, right? And then there's the aspect of the common good. The common good is the whole idea that God is good and his goodness is such that it's not only us as Christians experience it, but even unbelievers. Matthew 5 writes, he causes his sun to rise on the evil people and the good people. He sends his rain on the righteous and the unrighteous, right? How cool is that? Is it the fact that despite the fact that you and I are so sinful, somehow we still get to experience good things like love and friendship and beauty. And we take these things for granted, but it's a miracle of God, right? But not only that, even though you and I somehow are not perfect people, we are still able to produce good things like food, like shelter, and so on, right? But how do we experience these good things like food, for example? How does a plate of food reach my table in the morning? Surely a farmer somewhere had to cultivate his land. And somehow, somebody with a logistics company has to get the produce and it needs to be transported. Somehow there needs to be banking that exists in between all of that so that there can be a transfer of the resources, right? And so we see that God's goodness, how do people experience the goodness of God? It is through business. It is through work, right? The second greatest commandment, Jesus says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. A dualistic mindset immediately begins to think, how do I love my neighbor as myself? Prayer, maybe I need to go and feed the poor. And all those are great things. We need to do them. But it means so much more than that, right? And I'm just going to end with this particular quote. Dorothy Sayers, she actually makes this quote, which I thought is beautiful. She says, the church's approach to an intelligent carpenter, someone who makes tables or wooden stuff, is usually confined to telling him, don't get drunk. Don't do bad things during your off time. Come to church on Sunday. But the church should be telling him that the biggest demand that your Christianity, your religion makes upon you, first and foremost, is this. You should make good tables. Right? And so to the degree that you and I would do our work as unto the Lord, it's spiritual work and it is pleasing to God. And finally, the sharing of the gospel. The Apostle Peter writes in 1 Peter chapter 3, he says, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks, brother, why are you so hopeful? And what that scripture does is it assumes that you and I are going to live our lives in such a way that people are going to look and say, hey man, you look so hopeful. Things are tough, but you look so hopeful. Why are you so hopeful? And that is an opportunity and a moment for the gospel.